It was the year 1903. Two brothers, Orville and Wilbur Wright, successfully tested a heavier-than-air powered aircraft, opening the door for men and women to take to the skies. As the years followed, the Wright brothers' name is still engraved as the only ones to make a contribution towards the early years of flight. Nobody knows how an aircraft can evolve from a 12-second complicated flight to mass-producing longer range and faster biplanes during World War I. That helped many American amateur pilots become professional flying aces to fight the German Air Force in Europe. The Wright brothers did not contribute the advancement and the mass production of biplanes for military use. It was actually a low man from Hammondsport, New York, who had a passion to build airplanes that broke every world record in the air during the late 1900s. Who is this unknown flyer, many would ask? His name is Glenn Curtiss. Glenn Hammond Curtiss was born on May 21, 1878 from Hammondsport, New York. As a young, intelligent child, his education only lasted up to 8th grade. Glenn had to help his family through a struggling financial ordeal. He took a job in the film industry known as the East Dry Plate and Film Company, which later on became Kodak. Later, he left the Eastman Dry Plate and Film Company to become a bicycle messenger for Western Union, which was a telegraph communications center. Glenn became highly skillful in bicycling by winning several races at the New York County Fair for a few years. In 1898, at the age of 19, Glenn Curtiss marries Lena Pearl Neth, who was 17 at the time. Despite their youth, both had very similar personalities. After their marriage, Glenn developed a love for repairing, designing, and selling bicycles from his hometown. His business became so popular that he expands his franchise in Bath, New York. By 1902, Glenn started building motorcycles along with his new company known as G.H. Curtiss Manufacturing Company. Glenn manufactures motorcycles along with powerful lightweight engines that he developed. The engine that Curtiss produced became the best available engine in the United States during that time period. In 1903, the same year as the Wright brothers developed the motorized flyer, Glenn became the first American motorcyclist champion, establishing a world record mile run in 56.6 seconds. Later, he won a 10-mile and a hill climb race. Curtiss had a daredevil attitude and was willing to risk his life to see his motorcycle go top speed. In 1906, as the leading motorist producers in the United States, he contacted the Wright brothers to see if they are interested in buying one of Curtiss's engines. The Wright brothers were fiercely independent and they refused Glenn's offer. However, a balloonist named Thomas Scott Baldwin heard about Glenn's powerful engine. He immediately contacted Glenn to purchase one of his engines for aero use. At the World's Fair in St. Louis, Baldwin built the airship called the California Aero and flew hundreds of feet above ground. Crowds below were stunned as the airship flew powerfully in the air. After the successful flight of California Aero, Baldwin partnered with Glenn to produce airships around the country. In January of 1907, in Ormond Beach, Florida, the daredevil Glenn rode a motorcycle known as the V8 to a smashing speed world record at 136 miles per hour. Newspaper journalists who gathered to witness his attempt earned him the title Fastest Man on Earth. Several months after Glenn's historic achievement, he joined a group known as the Aerial Experiment Association, or the AEA, which was founded by Alexander Graham Bell. The main goal of the AEA was to get man into the air since the Wright brothers were not willing to share the skies. The group consists of Alexander Graham Bell, Casey Baldwin, John Alexander Douglas McCurdy, and U.S. Army Lieutenant Thomas Selbridge. The Wright brothers, who were fiercely independent, won't allow any public viewing of their aircraft. However, on March 12, 1908, on Keuka Lake, located in New York, the AEA introduced the first ever public viewing of a heavier-than-air flight attempt. The group made their own aircraft version called the Red Wing. With Casey Baldwin at the controls, it took off from a frozen surface of the lake and it stayed in the air for 20 seconds, covering 318 feet 11 inches before it crashes to the ground. 2 months later, the AEA built another aircraft called the White Wing. This time, Alexander suggests to add horizontal rudders to keep the aircraft in a controlled flight. With Glenn Curtiss at the controls, the aircraft flew a distance of 1,017 feet. In the summer of 1908, a competition was introduced called the Scientific American Trophy. The rule was that the first aircraft can fly in a straight line for 1 kilometer will be the winner. From improvements from the red and white wing aircraft, Glenn Curtiss himself designed a new aircraft called the Junebug. He provided the aircraft with wing flaps for lateral control and, of course, his powerful Curtiss engine. On July 4, 1908, Curtiss flew the Junebug across a pleasant valley in Hammondsport with a distance of 5,090 feet, with 1,810 feet farther than required. It became the first officially recognized, pre-announced, and publicly observed flight in America and won the Scientific American Trophy. The AEA became the first group in North America besides the Wright brothers to design, build, and fly aircraft. About 8 months after the successful flight of the Junebug, the AEA was disbanded and the aircraft's designs were handed over to Glenn Curtiss, which makes him start his own aviation business. Later in August of 1909, held the world's first international aviation meet in Reims, France. Everyone who was involved with aviation at the time were at that event, except for the Wright brothers, who were busy selling their aircraft version across Europe. Glenn won the Gordon Bennett Trophy for breaking the speed record of 47 miles per hour with his plane called the Reims Racer. The Wright brothers now wanted to challenge the young Glenn Curtiss. On October the 4th, 1909, Wilbur Wright wowed New Yorkers when they took off from Governor's Island, New York, and flew for 20 miles for 33 minutes with over 1 million New Yorkers watching. Glenn strikes back when he built his own plane called the Hudson Flyer. On May 29, 1910, Glenn smashed a world record for the longest flight. Glenn took off from Albany, New York, and headed south towards New York City for the 151-mile journey. At the end, it took him 2 hours and 51 minutes when he landed at Governor's Island. Once again stunning New Yorkers, Curtiss won both a $10,000 prize and a permanent possession of the Scientific American Trophy. With his innovative spirit, Curtiss advanced beyond what the Wrights can accomplish, making Glenn Curtiss the leading aviator in the United States. As now the leading aviator, Glenn Curtiss now wants to focus on selling his aircraft into military service. In November of 1910, Glenn's partner named Eugene Ely became the first person to take off from a warship called the USS Birmingham and landed safely on shore. After the successful flight marked the beginning of a relationship between the United States Navy and Glenn Curtiss. In January of 1911, Eugene took off from San Bernardino, California and became the first aircraft to actually land on a Navy cruiser called the USS Pennsylvania in the San Francisco Harbor. A few days later, Glenn successfully tested his first seaplane called the A-1 by taking off for water and landing near a Navy ship. In May of 1911, the Navy ordered several of Glenn's A1C planes. The Navy earned him the title Father of American Naval Aviation. As World War I began in 1914, Glenn traveled to England and met another aviation expert named Thomas Sopwith. Thomas was building tractor planes. Instead of the propeller on the back of the plane from Curtis's earlier designs, Thomas put the propeller on the front to make the airplane more powerful. As the United States was drawn closer to war, the Army hired Curtis to make an easier-to-fly airplane for amateur pilots. Glenn hired a European airplane designer named Douglas Thomas. He designed and tested a tractor plane called the JN4, or for short, Jenny, with outstanding easier-to-fly standards. It can fly as high as 6,500 feet and highly durable against inclement weather. By the time the U.S. entered the war, the Jenny became the most famous World War I aircraft that was used for training only. Although it never saw combat in the European War, 95% of the World War I pilots used the aircraft for training. There was so much high demand for Jennies that Glenn opened factories in his hometown of Hammondsport and Buffalo to keep the production going, hiring over 10,000 workers. When World War I ended, the United States government ended the production of Jennies. With a huge amount of surpluses, the Jenny became part of the United States Postal Service to fly airmail services across the country. Also, the plane was now being sold into the civilian market for barnstorming uses. Barnstorming is where pilots for money would perform highly dangerous stunts in the air to entertain crowds below. Also, it was used for giving people rides from point A to B. As for Glenn Curtis, after the war, by the 1920s, he reduced his involvement in aviation by selling his own company and decided to move with his family down to Florida, where he could retire peacefully. He still continued to be involved with his life. He helped establish cities of Miami Springs and Opa-locka, and also build an airport and flying schools in Opa-locka, and would regularly hunt down in the Florida Everglades. In early July of 1930, Glenn suffered appendicitis and had a successful surgery to remove it. But on July 23, 1930, Glenn Curtis suffered a blood clot, and his private nurse found him dead on the floor in his hospital room. He is buried in the family plot in Pleasant Valley Cemetery in New York, not far from the location of his successful June bug flight occurred. Glenn Curtis, the unknown flyer from Hammondsport, New York, contributed his life to make aviation available to the public and pushing the limits of his aircraft to fly farther and faster. His designs for his aircraft are still being used today in commercial and private aviation. As Glenn Curtis would say, it is hard enough for anyone to map out a course of action and stick to it, particularly in the face of desires of one's friends, but it is definitely hard for an aviator to stay on the ground, waiting for just the right moment to go into the air.